Dies ist der Mauticast. Alles über Open Source Marketing Automation mit Mautic. Und das hier ist dein Gastgeber, Ecki Gümbel.
Ja, genau. Willkommen zu einer neuen Episode vom Mauticast. Wir haben die Nummer 18. Willkommen da draußen an den Rundfunkgeräten und willkommen, Thomas, zu Hause in deinem Homeoffice.
Hallo zusammen, hallo Eckart.
Hey, wir haben mal wieder eine vollgestopfte Folge, vielleicht sogar von dir vollgestopfteste ever. Und ich glaube, es sind ganz nette Sachen dabei. Wir haben als Hauptthema heute den Joey Keller dabei, den wir auch schon öfter erwähnt haben hier. Und der als E-Mail- und Mautic-Experte, Spezialist, Leiterhase, uns eine Menge aus seinem Leben erzählen wird und eine Menge Meinungen und Erfahrungen mitgeben wird. Joey ist in letzter Zeit ziemlich aktiv in den Foren und so weiter, deswegen auch in unseren anderen Themen fällt der Name ab und zu. Bevor wir dazukommen, starten wir aber mit was anderem, richtig?
Ja, es gibt tatsächlich eine sehr schöne Beispielkampagne. Da geht es um Voucher und Countdowns, wie man das gut anteasern kann. Die ist von Friendly.is, zu der Joey auch gehört.
Genau, geschrieben hat es aber der René Petri. Und er hat sich tatsächlich mal die Mühe gegeben, eine Kampagne ganz, ganz konkret zu beschreiben. Nicht nur, hier kann man dann irgendeinen Content hinmachen und dann hoffen, dass jemand das Formular ausfüllt, sondern der hat sich überlegt, so eine Countdown-Geschichte zu machen als Lead-Generierung, wo dann läuft, okay, jetzt nur noch 3 Tage, jetzt nur noch 2 Stunden, jetzt aber schnell. Das Ganze halt nicht nur auf einer Seite, sondern auch in einem Pop-up, also sprich Focus-Item, und auch im Formular. Überall läuft dieser Countdown und danach passiert dann halt was. Er erklärt dann halt noch, wie man eine E-Mail schickt nach Ablauf der Kampagne und oder nach Ablauf der, nach Erreichen dieses Countdowns und wie man dann Segmente bildet, um hinterher zu agieren mit diesen generierten Leads. Also einmal von vorn bis hinten durchdekliniert. Sehr netter Blogpost. Link in den Shownotes natürlich.
Ganz genau. Und dann gibt es noch ein Nerd-Thema, sage ich mal. Im Forum haben wir das gefunden. Da geht es darum, wie man HTML in Kontaktfeldern benutzen kann.
Genau, das Problem ist ja, oder das coole Feature von Mautic ist ja, dass aus Sicherheitsgründen Tags daraus gefiltert werden. Das könnte ja sowas wie bold in HTML sein, aber es könnten auch böse JavaScript-Sachen sein, die dann irgendwas machen, Cross-Site-Scripting für die Security-Experten. Das will natürlich kein Mensch, deswegen wird es rausgefiltert, wie sich das gehört. Ja. Dann gibt es aber Fälle, wo Leute zum Beispiel in Formularen, in versteckten Feldern dann solche Inhalte doch speichern wollen und sagen, okay, und da steht jetzt ein Text, der irgendwie formatiert ist. Und um das zu ermöglichen, gibt es einen Trick, der wurde halt in einem Forumartikel erklärt, und zwar von unserem Freund Steno Kusmani gibt es ein Plugin namens Custom Text Bundle, was man dafür nehmen kann, was im Prinzip so arbeitet, dass ein komplexerer Text einfach umgewandelt wird in eine Zeichenkette, in einen Hash, der kann gefahrlos gespeichert werden und wird beim Verwenden dann wieder zurückgewandelt. Und das haben Leute probiert und passt super für diesen Fall. Also wenn ihr das auch habt, schaut euch das an. Link, ihr wisst schon wo.
Ja, und das nächste, es ist wieder Joey, das ist echt die Joey-Folge. Es gab im Forum eine Diskussion, wie man Stages effektiv benutzen kann. Und auch da hatte Joey dann 1-2 Beiträge zugeleistet, die das ein bisschen aus seiner Sicht erklären und wie er es benutzt.
Genau, das ist jetzt wieder im Forum und er ist einer von vielen Leuten, die damit diskutieren. Von daher sehr nett, da gibt es ja auch keinen richtigen, kein falsch. Es gibt einfach so ein bisschen so Best Practices oder Dinge, die Leute so tun. Eine Sache, also ja, fangen wir erstmal damit an, warum überhaupt Stages? Stages oder Lebenszyklusphasen unterscheidet man ja im normalen Marketing sowieso, im Inbound-Marketing schon erst recht. Diese üblichen Geschichten wie anonymer Besucher der Webseite, wiederkehrender, bekannter, also Lead, was auch immer, wenn ich bei der Lead-Generierung bin oder direkt Käufer, wenn ich beim Online-Kauf bin. Bestandskunde jedenfalls irgendwann, vielleicht auch ein abgefallener Bestandskunde. Das sind so übliche Stages, die man unterscheidet. Und der konkrete Funnel unterscheidet sich halt auch danach, wo bin ich eigentlich, in welcher Branche oder in welchem Segment, B2C, B2B, unterscheidet man tatsächlich unterschiedliche Funnel-Stages. Und die kann man natürlich auch in seinem Mautic abbilden. Und warum will man das? Es gibt zwei Aspekte. Das eine ist, ich will eine Transparenz haben, wie ist mein Funnel überhaupt so gefüllt, wie entwickelt er sich über die Zeit, ja. Wie vielleicht habe ich so in der Pipeline sozusagen. Und das andere ist, ich will auf Basis dieser Stages agieren. Und da ist so eine Binsenweisheit, dazu brauche ich Segmente. Das heißt, die Leute empfehlen zum Teil, Segmente statt Stages zu verwenden. Oder was man halt auch machen kann, ist Segmente auf Basis von Stages. Dass man einfach einen Segmentfilter hat, der sagt, wenn Stage gleich Bestandskunde ist, dann kommt in das Segment Bestandskunde. Herzlichen Glückwunsch.
Jawohl.
Ja, und ja, Randthema noch, wie wechselt man die Stage eigentlich? Also wird das aus einer Kampagne heraus getriggert, dass man jetzt einen Stage-Wechsel hat? Typischerweise ja. Das ist auch zu berücksichtigen. Und die Pitfalls und die verschiedenen Meinungen kann man schön in diesem Forum-Post sich anschauen.
Mhm. Ja, sehr gut. Und dann gab es einen ganz interessanten Fall im Forum. Es gab einen Menschen, ich habe den Namen gerade gar nicht parat, der suchte Leute, die für ihn ein Plugin entwickeln. Also im Prinzip möchte er ganz gerne Dev-Arbeit sponsoren. Und wir haben uns ein bisschen auch gefragt, okay, wo gehört das wohl wirklich hin und gibt es da vielleicht, ja, fast schon zu böse formuliert, eine Lücke im System? Gibt es einen guten Platz, wo man das aktiver angehen kann? Denn das ist ja ein sehr schöner Fall, dass jemand sagt, ich könnte Hilfe gebrauchen und würde es auch gern bezahlen.
Konkret ging es ja sogar darum, ein vorhandenes Plugin zu erweitern. Also kein großes Ding, aber vielleicht doch wieder so ein typischer Fall, was Mautic weiterbringt und wo es völlig normal ist, dass jemand auch sagt, ich möchte gerne ein paar Euro einwerfen. Ja, ja. Austin Klüger war das übrigens. Und der ist halt ins Forum gegangen und hat gesagt, okay, ich schaue jetzt mal in der Kategorie Commercial und sage, ist da jemand, der das kann? Aber die zugrunde liegende Frage, die ist tatsächlich noch ein bisschen größer. Ne? Also wie ist es überhaupt, wenn ich einen Mautic-Service suche, wie ist es vielleicht, wenn ich Mitarbeiter suche oder wenn ich was anbieten will oder so, ist das alles in dieser Forum-Kategorie Commercial oder gibt es vielleicht andere Dinge, andere Plätze, die sinnvoll sind? Ne? Es geht im Slack die Marketplace, den Channel Marketplace. Und ich habe das Gefühl, da würde ein bisschen Struktur tatsächlich ein bisschen helfen, weil dieser Fall ist nicht unüblich. Ich brauche einen Mautic-Dienstleister für irgendwas. Ja. Das Mindeste wäre, dass diese Commercial-Kategorie ein bisschen besser erklärt und vielleicht ein bisschen promotet wird sogar, damit Leute es auch dauernd besser nutzen können. Mhm. Also laut Beschreibung passt das alles dahin. Spam ist eine kleine Gefahr dabei, aber die Nutzung ist dann halt noch nicht so groß. Da ist halt in letzter Zeit ab und zu was gekommen, aber ansonsten eher wenig. Und ich glaube, das liegt halt zum Beispiel auch an der Promotion. So, ja. Und wir haben jetzt intern schon mal ein bisschen diskutiert und ich würde gerne die Frage an dich, liebe Hörerinnen oder lieber Hörer, stellen, welche Ideen oder welche Gedanken hättest du denn dazu, wenn du Unternehmen bist, wie suchst du deine Dienstleister, was würdest du dir wünschen von der Mautic-Community, wenn du selbst Dienstleister bist oder Freelancer oder was auch immer, welche Möglichkeiten würdest du dir vorstellen, welche Ideen hättest du, um halt besser Kunden und Anbieter zusammenzubringen? Ja. Und das Ganze muss man sicherlich unterscheiden in kurzfristigen Ideen, zu sagen, okay, lass uns doch diese Forum-Kategorie nehmen und nur besser nutzen und vielleicht langfristigere Ideen, wo man ja ein bisschen mehr spinnen kann und sagen, okay, wäre doch toll, wenn man dies und das alles hätte.
Genau, ja, also mal her mit den Visionen und den Ideen dazu.
Genau, das können wir gerne direkt diskutieren in irgendwelchen Kanälen, Twitter etc., Public oder auch Private in LinkedIn etc. Also schreibt uns gerne an und vielleicht machen wir dazu dann auch einfach mal einen Forenpost, wo wir das sammeln, solange es denn nicht geheim ist, und dann an der Stelle weiter diskutieren können.
Ja, finde ich super. Und wo wir gerade schon über Sponsorship sprechen, tatsächlich gibt es jetzt eine erweiterte Möglichkeit, das Mautic-Projekt zu sponsoren. Es besteht die Möglichkeit, in Stufen, kleinen und großen, durch einen regelmäßigen Beitrag die Entwicklung in allen Bereichen von Mautic zu unterstützen. Dazu gibt es auch eine Landingpage auf mautic.org. Der Link dazu ist wie immer in den Shownotes. Das heißt, für euch da draußen, überlegt mal, ob das für euch eine gute Möglichkeit ist.
Genau. Der Benefit ist, ab 100 Euro oder 100 Dollar pro Monat bekommt ihr nicht nur eine Erwähnung, sondern auch einen Backlink und das Logo auf der genau. mautic.org/sponsors-Seite. Und da gibt es schon einige. Also vielen Dank an alle, die das bereits tun. Und hier sei vor allem mal die Info gestreut, dass es sowas gibt, weil ich glaube, allein schon die Nennung und der Backlink ist vielleicht Motivation genug für manchen, am besten ein paar Euro einzuwerfen.
Jawohl. Und dann, Eckart, was ist denn unser Feature-Wunsch?
Ja, wir haben so viele Wünsche. Aber ich bin tatsächlich in diesem Monat über einen gestolpert, der dem nahe kommt, wo wir auch schon, ich glaube, im Podcast sogar mal drüber gesprochen haben, aber was wir oft in Kampagnen haben, ist dieses Thema, wir wollen ja gern wissen, wo jemand herkommt und danach filtern können und segmentieren können und dann agieren können. Und es gibt jetzt einen konkreten Feature-Wunsch, der sagt, speichert doch bitte die UTM-Parameter ab, mit denen ein Lead reinkommt. Also wenn das aus irgendeiner bestimmten Kampagne reinkommt, dann wäre es auch super zu wissen, aus welcher ist der reingekommen.
Ja.
Der Link dazu auch in den Shownotes. Bitte, wenn euch das interessiert, ich finde es sehr spannend, wenn euch das auch interessiert, dann votet ruhig dafür, damit wir ein Meinungsbild haben, wie spannend ist das für euch. Jo, so, und jetzt haben wir einen ganzen Haufen Tipps und Tricks diskutiert. Tricks. und ja, wie schon mehrfach erwähnt, ein Teil davon kommt in letzter Zeit sehr gerne auch mal von Freund Joey. Und das ist ein Thema, was ich mit ihm spreche und warum er im Moment so aktiv ist und was sein Hintergrund ist. Und vor allem ganz konkret das Thema E-Mail und Mautic. Auf geht's.
Yeah, welcome, Joey Keller. Hey, Joey, how are you doing? You are in Budapest right now, right? Hey, good to have you on the Mauticast. We have been in touch a couple of times in the past, and I mentioned you recently because of one extensive forum post that you did. And I thought it's high time for us to speak because your name pops up again and again, and you're doing good content, and I thought it's worth having a chat. So glad to have you here.
Thanks so much for inviting me. I'm a loyal listener of the podcast anyway, so yay. I'm happy to be here. And yes, I am popping up lately in the Mauric forums. I love to contribute, so I'm glad if someone finds it useful what I'm posting there.
Okay, yeah, let's talk about that later. But first, tell us a little bit about your professional background. I know you started off in the airline business, is that right?
Yeah, well, actually, that was like the second step. I'm a tourism major, and I got to the airline, actually, because I wrote my diploma work from e-business for airlines. And at that time, the Hungarian Airlines just looked for someone who is knowledgeable about that. And I remember in my diploma work, we had topics like, what is a banner? So it was in the year 2000, long time ago. And I could say many new things to the people who were very closely acquainted with telex machines before, and email was a big deal. And yeah, so I became a member of a team which built the first e-ticketing for the airline and the website. And yeah, it was pretty wild ride at that time. And then I moved from the airlines to be a online marketer, worked by a social network and also by a company which mostly dealt with large-scale marketing, online marketing, email marketing. So I have a strong background in email.
So that was in the US, is that right?
That was an American company, but I'm a freelancer. I was a nomad, so I stayed mostly in Budapest. Yes, I lived in the US and some other places in Europe as well, but that was mostly for learning languages. So for a while, I'm stationed here in Budapest, and I'm working from here as a digital nomad.
Yeah, and We've been going back and forth in English for a while until it occurred to me that you are also fluent in German. But let's stick with English for the sake of the podcast here. okay, cool. So the when you say you've been a freelancer for quite a while now, that has changed recently, is that correct?
Yeah, that changed. Well, when I was working for the American company or American companies, let's put it this way, I decided to be a full-time freelancer again beginning of this year, but I had a chance to join Friendly, which is a Friendly Automate. It's basically a Modic service provider, which focuses on ethical marketing tools. We have two products, Matomo and Modic so far. I joined in April and became CTO pretty soon. So I am officially employee number one as well. So it's a small startup.
Mm. And that is in Switzerland, correct?
That is in Switzerland,
So fascinating that Switzerland becomes like the epicenter of Modic and Modic SaaS companies, etc.
That seems so. Yeah, I'm also shocked about it and surprised, but quite happy.
Yeah, no, it's good. When I looked up Friendly IS, which is a domain, and I put that in the show note. When I looked at their website, the one thing that also struck me that you are an open startup, and I have to admit I didn't know what that term means or that it even exists. Can you explain to us the concept of the open startup?
Yeah, sure. So. That's also my first time to work for an open startup. Open startup is that we are completely open about everything. That includes our product backlog, our uptimes, our plans, our incomes, the number of clients, our salaries, our costs, everything basically is out there. So you go to our website and it's on the bottom of the page. You can look into all the data. So we're trying to build trust with this. We're trying to build traction as well. And we're playing with open cards. And it's really interesting. I mean, our customers love it. It's also a great topic to speak about.
Yeah, it's certainly very, very modern and aggressive too. But I have to think about it myself, about the implications, I have to admit. But you didn't invent this, did you?
No. Well, there are many open startups. Actually, if you look at barometrics.com, you can see a couple of companies. Mm. Buffer is one of the most well-known foregoers, so to say.
Hmm. Yeah, cool. Really good. Now, what people read from you is mostly about email, and I assume that is because that has been your major expertise in the past, and it is your passion still. Is that a fair description?
Yeah, well, I found Modic because I was working for... So, in America... Everything is bigger. So when you work for a marketing company, then you send monthly like 20, 40, 50, 100 million emails. Mm. And there's certain ways to do this. And Modic doesn't fit in this, actually, because you have to scale it already in such a way, which is not so easy. So we rarely use Modic. We use Modic for smaller companies. And I found it fascinating that you can build relationship with customers with the help of Modic. And actually, that's the ultimate goal, because the best inboxing you will get if you're building relationships. So Modic is actually the best tool for inboxing, I have to say, from all the tools I've tried. Mm. And you can have great, you know, platform which sends millions of emails, but if you manage to build relationships, you will inbox everywhere.
Yep.
So I was quite happy with Modic. I'm also happy that it's not scaled for 100 million emails a month, at least not out of the box.
Correct.
And I quite enjoy working with it. So it became also my main expertise. And I'm really geeking out in the forum about email. So whenever there is a question about inboxing, I try to answer and I try to try to show people how to inbox better.
Yeah, I noticed that you have a lot of technical insights that you share, but you are also active in educating people how to get the most value out of email, and regardless of technology, just how to use email and email nurturing and everything the right way.
So in general, inboxing is really or emailing. Well, the ultimate goal is to inbox. The ultimate goal is to have a response, to sell something, to have a positive response from your contacts. Mm. And you can only do it if you inbox. So that's usually the number one. How can I get to the inbox? And that usually comes down to a couple of things, like how often you send, what is the response rate when you send. So how you structure your marketing campaigns, putting the openers first, the non-responsive ones later. How you create, for example, in Moric, you can create a campaign when you separate your contacts into different segments based on how often you send an email, or how often they react. I'm sorry. So if someone opens an email frequently, they will get, let's say, three times a week from you.
Yeah.
But if they not opening three emails, then you put them in another segment where they're getting like a digest of the previous two emails. So they just get one email per week. So you can do these kind of tricks. And I like to share this on the forum also about the settings and authentication is also very important.
Yeah.
So
just to make sure that we have everybody on board here, can you give a simple example to our listeners of a campaign that involves inboxing?
So inboxing means that you are landing in the inbox.
Yeah.
That's what I meant. So for example, you have any email campaign, even if it's a newsletter.
Mm-hmm.
By inboxing, I mean you're delivering to the inbox. So Gmail introduced different kinds of tabs. Also, Yahoo recently changed their filtering process, so you're more likely to land in spam box. Hotmail is having very strict restrictions about landing in the inbox. So when I say about inboxing, that's the moment when you actually land in front of your contact.
Okay.
That's the most valuable spot in the person's inbox is when you are in the inbox, not in the promotions, not in the spam, but you are in the inbox. Because delivering an email, that's easy. You can do it.
Mm.
But landing in front of your contacts with all this noise, that's really hard.
Mm. Do you have any tools for testing the various stages of the process of getting into the inbox?
So I use Glock apps because they have such a tool that you can send out like 70 or 80 test emails, their own emails, and they will tell you where you landed, inbox, spam box, promotions, and so on, divided by ESP. So Gmail, Hotmail, gmx.ch, gmx.de, you know, Russian providers, Czech providers, you name it. And they give you suggestions. So what you should tweak in order to land more in the inbox. And this is a very good tool. So if you are a beginner, I suggest it for you. You can also go to the pricing page and do some tricks that you have to pay less, actually. So I highly recommend that because you don't need all their services.
Yeah.
And you can pay up to, I don't know, like really like $15, $20 a month. And with Glock apps, the point is it's really cool. They will tell you something wrong with your authentication. You should add this line to your domain. Or you should use more text, less images, or your HTML is breaking because of that, or there is a dead link. That's one of the things which is very important. Now, the other thing, what many people don't know, when you try to inbox, your domain reputation also counts into the big number, I would say. You get like a credit score, and this big number depends on all the different parts, your domain reputation, IP reputation, what you're sending with, how fast you're sending with, what relationship you have with your contact, and so on. So domain reputation is one of them. And when you send out, let's say you install Moric on moric.com, whatever, and that's where you're sending from. That's your sending domain. This will leave a mark in each email due to tracking reasons. And if your links are pointing somewhere else, then that link's domain reputation also will count. And if one of them is bad, that can pull your domain down and your whole inboxing down. So that means you have a campaign and you're sending out 1 million emails. Then you're like, okay, I burned this domain. I want to switch to another one. So you switch to samedomain.net, but you send with the same Marek. That Marek domain will be already tainted and it will pull down your whole domain reputation and you will not inbox. I don't know if that's too technical, but it's important that all the ingredients in your email has to have a good reputation in order to properly inbox.
That's the bottom line, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I think if you want to get it right, if you want to do it large scale, it is a lot of fine tuning.
Yeah, a lot of small things. Yeah, that's correct.
And a lot of pitfalls which can really hurt you badly. Yeah, good point. Now, let's talk about Mordic as a tool for doing all this, because this is email. Oh no! Before we go there, I have another thing that we've been discussing back and forth. With clients, and that is, how good does email work in 2020? Do you still believe it, specifically outside of the US?
It's a very good question. So email has a renaissance, because I think that all the ESPs like Gmail, Hotmail, and all the rest, including the spam filters like Barracuda and all the spam filters basically on the market, are focusing on one thing: be the best possible spam filter ever, or have the best possible spam filter. So what's the result? The result is that you're getting less spam. So if you're getting less spam, then you can, the honest companies, the good businesses, which actually want to build relationship and they have a legit reason to write you, have a lot better chance to inbox. So I say, if you are a legit business and you are an honest emailer, it's the best time for you now, because there is a way, like the major ESPs are filtering out the rest of the bad guys. So I think that now it's a great time to be an emailer, and it still has the best return on investment.
I guess that is the point, right? So if you get to the face of the customer, they still react to it, and if it's done right, of course, it involves brains.
Yes.
And in the end, the cost is okay.
I guess, it's very low.
Yeah. Okay, now what I wanted to say previously was Mordic as a tool. There are a million of ideas what else we could do to make email or Mordic an even better email tool, and specifically the builder. There's been multiple initiatives now to come up with new interfaces, and I asked you the other week about that, about your opinion about it, and you said not so convinced that it's there yet, but also not so convinced that it's really important, and that really stunned me. Can you talk about that?
So it's two things. So when you have a business, Mordic as service, it's very important that everything is shiny, it works out of the box, and there's lots of eye candies. When you first try to recruit a new client, then you have to make sure that it looks good, because that's what they're gonna decide on, that what looks good and easy to use. Now, you can show the Mordic email builder and the page builder, and you can just say, this is something you've seen many times, drag and drop, great. But once they start playing around with it and they realize that, so how do I make my own template with a couple of clicks? How do I make sure that the different sections are not suddenly, being embedded into each other because I put 5 pixels to the left. So everybody knows there are some issues with the legacy email builder. It's not the best, and people will notice it, and it is really frustrating when someone tries to play with it and then suddenly it just doesn't work. And everybody knows that. And it's been a project for a long time. And I see very good signs. But when you try to have emails that actually land in your inbox, then you should forget all these eye candies. The best performing campaigns are still the text-based ones. That's why, for example, we created a Gmail-like template for our clients, because it's super easy to use. It's like basically you are sending a Gmail. It's ugly, yeah, sure, but it surely delivers. And if you want to go fancy, then I think sure you should have a better email builder. But once you create one template, then you can also stick to it, and it's going to be fine. So you can live without it, but I would be more happy simply because it's the product itself, like Mautic itself, is easier to introduce to people, and for the new customers, it's easier to pick up the email creation.
I 100% agree about the importance of text-only emails, and I always have a hard time to explain to clients that maybe it's not the greatest idea to have a fancy and shiny HTML email, because as a user, you really don't give a crap. It's annoying.
You want to test in, 19 different email readers.
That's the other
thing. I don't.
Developers love it. What did I want to say?
More thing we talked about is before that, we talked about this, that clients actually like to play around with the emails because that's the moment of creativity for them. And we are taking that away right now.
Yeah.
So that's one of, but at the end of the day, it will, they will calm down and they will just want to focus on their own content.
Yeah.
So I would be really happy to see a modern email builder and page builder, especially the page builder, maybe even a form builder. So I hope that's going to happen soon.
Yeah. We have movement everywhere, but one step after the, not after the other, all in parallel, but. Not landing in time. But I really wanted to ask you what you mean by Gmail-like template, because I don't get that. What does an email from Gmail look like?
So if you take a Gmail and write to yourself a Gmail and take out the HTML what Gmail produces as a default...
Yeah.
And turn it into a template.
Okay, got it. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's basically a very simple, bare, naked template, almost like a text.
Yeah. Okay. So it is HTML. It is better looking than ASCII text.
Yeah.
And it's very familiar to people.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Good point. We did already touch about progress in Mautic, and I know that you are contributing there and willing to do more there, but where you massively contribute today is the forums and educating people, both in friendly you in person on the forums. So tell me a little bit of your motivations. How did that come to happen?
So a couple of months ago, there was a post where someone was complaining that why never anyone ever answers. And I felt really bad because I also asked a couple of questions. Sometimes I got an answer, sometimes I didn't. Mm. And it's really frustrating. And I was like, okay, you know what? I'm going to answer everything I can. And I got hooked on that. So now you see me 3-4 times checking the forum. And if I know the answer, I try to answer. And if I can, I do a longer one. Maybe someone can refer to it in the future. What I noticed is mostly is the same things, like emails, cron jobs, clear the cache, standard things, and rarely some other issues. But mostly it's also coming from the fact that people don't see the whole picture because there is not yet a tutorial which takes your hand and then educates you until you are a master of Mautic.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked about it, that it's really hard to do because people coming from different backgrounds, they use the business for different things.
Yeah.
They need completely different modules. Maybe someone will never use a page builder, or they don't care about stages.
Yeah.
So, but I think that sharing these ideas, how to use certain features in the forum, opens conversations. And these conversations are leading to great realizations that there are some people who also contribute like me, and we are like, you know, all of us sitting, oh, okay, I didn't know you can do that. So there's lots of aha experiences and heurekas happening in the forum. And since I am not a coder on that level that I could contribute, I think this is my way to chip in.
Yeah, excellent. I agree that we need more content, and we also need more visibility of the quality content. So having that in the forums is a great start. You on your own side have a collection like in an inventory of tutorials that you found in the web. So I put that in the show notes too, if you like. Or if you don't mind.
Okay, I make sure that I publish it by then because it's unpolished at the moment. But thank you. That's a good good incentive for me to finish up that page.
Yeah, cool. And the education team and Leon, they are working hard to bring the knowledge, the knowledge base of Mordic.org, the new one, live, and that is slower moving, but hopefully the result will be really comprehensive and will give people access to all the good content that is out there in the internet, and motivate, inspire people to contribute and to add or to update whatever it takes to make it even more comprehensive. So these bits and pieces in the knowledge base is one thing. Guided tutorials that connect the pieces is another thing. There's more to it, like international versions or multi-language things, etc. But I hear that time and again that is the biggest inhibitor to getting started with Mordic is the lack of clear path in education. And yeah, the good thing is we're getting there. And of course, at the core of it is people like you who are willing and able to produce excellent content. So thank you very much for that.
Yeah, you're welcome. I'll be trying to do it. So there are some amazing contents out there. Like you said about this page where I created, and it's on my website. Mm-hmm. There are people really, I'm going to miss someone out, but like Alex Hammerschmidt or Chris Calabro or guys from Cactus, Auto Eyes, Yosu, lots of people are making amazing tutorials, mm-hmm. which are little islands of knowledge. And the best would be to really connect these tutorials somehow and make them in a form, like you said, that make it, you know, that we can post it in the knowledge base. I think that we try by friendly, we are trying to create example websites, example businesses. We have actually one already up and running where we look at this business. We created a web shop, which doesn't work. It's just an example web shop with products and working Mordic installation. And we are guiding from zero to hero, guiding the owner, the imaginary owner, how to use Mordic and what to use it for, and put it in a video series. So that's something we will try. And if it works, maybe we can do the same thing also for the knowledge base for more broader audience.
Yeah, very cool. Lovely. Which brings me to maybe a last question, and that is the Mordicon, obviously, which is coming up. Call for speakers is open. Did you apply already?
I did not, but I think I will. Maybe I will talk about emailing in general. Like the question comes up, what do you need for a good campaign, or what are the basic requirements for having the chance to inbox at all. And maybe I will do something where I'm summarizing these and showing how to go through the different tools and how to use them. Yeah. Maybe that would be interesting for some people.
Oh, definitely. Oh, yeah. We need a lot of stuff like that. And you're welcome to do more than one.
Cool.
Okay, dokie. Yeah. Did we forget anything? Anything else you want to mention, maybe?
No, I think we covered pretty much everything. So it was fun.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I like it too. And I once again, I appreciate the work that you do. So keep it up. And I hope to talk to you soon. Thank you very much for today. And
sure.
Take care.
You're very welcome. Thanks. Bye.
Thanks, Jerry. Bye-bye.
Ja, das Interview haben wir ja ein paar Tage vorher aufgezeichnet und Joey erzählt ja, dass er einen Talk für die Mauticon einreichen will und der ist jetzt tatsächlich auch eingereicht. Insofern, wir freuen uns alle, ihn dann da auch reden zu hören.
Ja, genau, Daumen hoch, Joey, sehr gut. Mhm. Und noch läuft der Call for Speakers, also wenn du selbst auch noch ein Thema hast, dann sei nochmal daran erinnert, es gibt zwei Formate, das eine ist der Lightning Talk mit 5 Minuten, wo man halt irgendeine Kleinigkeit pitchen oder anteasern kann. Oder der normale Talk, wo man halt tatsächlich über ein Thema jeglicher Art was erzählen kann. Über Best Practices in der Verwendung, über technische Dinge, über die Zukunft, über seine eigenen Services kann man alles einreichen. Und natürlich über Community-Themen. Und wir sind ja wirklich sehr divers, was die Tracks angeht und auch was die Sprachen angeht. Also wenn ihr zum Beispiel in Deutsch was anreichen wollt, auch das herzlich willkommen.
Ja.
Genau, endet in ein paar Tagen, ich weiß nicht genau wann, aber dann ist halt auch schon wieder Annahmeschluss. Was auch in wenigen Tagen ist, ist am kommenden Samstag, dem 26. das Meetup Lagos, also in Nigeria. Das Ganze findet weiterhin online statt und das ist vielleicht nochmal ein Tipp auch für die deutschen Hörer, denn da sind tatsächlich Referenten, wirklich hochkarätig aus aller Welt. Das lohnt sich total, sich das mal anzuschauen oder da mal reinzuschauen, ob das ein Thema ist, was dich vielleicht auch interessieren könnte. Oder auch auf YouTube einfach zu gucken, die Aufzeichnung aus der Vergangenheit, also Meetup Lagos. Der Tobi macht da einen super Job, gute Referenten anzuholen. Also auch da Daumen hoch.
Cool, cool.
Jo, damit haben wir es auch wieder geschafft für diese Folge. Thomas, vielen Dank für...
Gerne.
Den ganzen Input. Für die alle, die jetzt nur so zuhören. Die Vorbereitung ist ja auch immer tatsächlich ein spannender Teil für uns. Und wenn wir da sitzen und diskutieren, was ist vielleicht interessant, was möchte man dazu sagen, wie tief will man reingehen und so weiter, bringt uns das auch schon mal ein Stückchen weiter. Und trotzdem freuen wir uns über euer Feedback, euer Input, eure Wünsche. Deswegen nicht nur, also ja, Sternebewertungen so auch immer sehr gerne, weiterempfehlen, auf alle Fälle auch gerne, aber wir hören auch sehr gerne von euch Wünsche, Vorschläge, auch negative Anmerkungen oder konstruktive Kritik.
Gerne.
Meinetwegen auch so, ja, Stimme ist zu doof oder was immer. Sehen müsst ihr uns zum Glück ja nicht. Aber ich hoffe, wir hören uns bald wieder. In diesem Sinne, bis dahin, macht's gut, ciao.
Tschüss zusammen.
Tschüssi.